Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lilkindy. Take 15 minutes with me and Senator John DeFrancisco so he can tell you what's happening in the New York State Senate. Hi, Senator. How are you today?
I'm doing well, thank you.
So this is the last week of session.
I hope.
Me too. Has there anything been accomplished, or what are we looking at?
Well, you know, at the end of session, what always happens is everybody wants something, and the idea is to try to compromise and get a little compromise on what the goals are for everybody and try to come up with some final legislation. Right now, unlike just about any other year I've been here, everything has been left to the last week, whether it's mayoral control of the schools by the mayor of New York City, whether it's rent control, whether it's the private school tax breaks, the tax credit, and sexual abuse on campus and what the procedure should be, modifications of the SAFE Act. It goes on and on. Nothing seems to close down, and everything seems to go on, and there's no real agreement. So anything can happen this week.
All right. So let's talk about some legislation that was passed last week. You were here a few weeks ago, and you talked about the lack of details when it comes to the state's energy plan, reforming the energy vision, it's called. And the Senate passed a bill that would require cost-benefit analysis to figure out how it will affect utility bills. Let's take a look at that debate.
Wouldn't any analysis of the cost, benefits, and rate impacts of REV and the alternative required by this bill potentially be so broad and general as to not be particularly useful to the legislature?
Well, it's useful to me, and it's useful to the members of the AARP who sent a memo in support to know what additional fees and so forth they're likely to have to pay based upon this new vision that we have. I think it's extremely important to have that information. And besides, if this was such a horrible burden I'm trying to impose to get these reports done, they wouldn't have imposed the deadlines on themselves. So I just feel it's not an imposition, and the prudent way to do things, especially in the billions of dollars industry of energy, and the potential fees that might result, we should know what we're getting into before we get into it, and I mean financially.
So the report was due in December. You asked for it during the budget hearings. You asked for it again a few weeks ago during another hearing, and now the legislation.
Yeah, and I guess it really is in legislation form, in bill form. Do what you're supposed to do before we get into another type of vision that to see whether or not that vision is blind vision or whether it makes some kind of sense. Remember, not so long ago, the governor put out his vision of energy, namely the energy highway. Mm-hmm. Now, that vision is still a vision because no one knows what happened to it and where it is presently. And then the REV, the new energy vision, has been touted as the greatest thing that could ever happen in the state of New York. In one of the energy hearings that I co-chaired, the people there that's supposed to be, well, know the vision, didn't seem to know much about it. So if we can't get answers, we're going to try to put it through legislation. Who in their right mind would spend a substantial amount of money on anything without seeing what the benefits are and compare it to what the costs are? And Senator Krueger sounded as if this was some novel approach I was taking, and that how could I do something like this? Well, consumers and constituents do this every day of the week, and their stakes aren't nearly as high. So it passed. My guess, judging from the questions by Senator Krueger, the Assembly will think this is something that's tried to delay it when it's trying to move it forward. Mm-hmm. And I'm hearing the Assembly won't touch it. So you can only do what you can do.
Well, the goal here is to reduce emissions by 80% in the year 2050.
Correct. And that's what the Energy Highway was supposed to do. And then that got scrapped for whatever reason. No one seems to know.
All right. So another piece of legislation, you think it's a good idea to have people who are convicted of terrorist acts to be put on a registry, and 16 of your colleagues voted no for that, and this is how you responded.
You know, every once in a while, I wonder if I'm hearing correctly, because the world seems to be going on its head. When we in this state don't, by the way, all terrorists don't go to jail for life. Some actually get out, so they have a time after that to be on a registry, just like sex offenders. But what's really contradictory in my mind, we're concerned about the civil liberties of a person convicted of terrorism, but we, without even a thought, decide to set up a registry for all lawful citizens to record when they obtain ammunition, from whom, without any indication there was anything, any wrongdoing, at a substantial cost, a cost of so substantial that we haven't even done it yet. And that's why we passed the bill the other day to eliminate that part of the so-called SAFE Act. So, bad people should be followed. Bad people who have committed bad acts should be followed and registered, just like sex offenders. Law-abiding citizens should not have to be looked over their shoulder as long as they're following the law and doing what good citizens should do.
So who would be in control of this information and how would it work?
Well, it's basically the Homeland Security, all the law enforcement activities. There's about three or four organizations that are involved with compiling, keeping, and giving access to other law enforcement agencies the whereabouts, hopefully, of people who have been convicted of acts of terrorism. And you know, acts of terrorism aren't only blowing up buildings and killing thousands and thousands of people. There are other smaller acts in trying to create a cell, of other activities trying to encourage people to go overseas and become part of terrorists. That, you know, those are not life sentence situations. So one of the arguments was, you know, why do we need a registry? Because it's as if they're never going to be seen again. Well, that has proven, unfortunately, not to be true.
Is the Assembly on board with this?
Very, very, very unlikely. There's a different point of view of life in the Assembly, and run by the downstate Democrats. A totally different view. My best example, well, you look at it, I passed Tiffany's Law for years, that if you kill somebody by or commit a DWI in a boat, then you do it in a car, that's not two DWIs because it's different vehicles. Every year I try to pass that. There's some objectionable thing by the Assembly, and what they object to usually is higher sentences and object to anything that would call for accountability in the criminal law. During the 2 years the New York City Democrats also control the Assembly, I voted against, and so did all the Republicans, $14 billion in new taxes in 2 years, $14 billion in new spending. They believe the government has got to take care of you from even before you leave the womb to the time you leave this earth. Government's got to take care of you. And we wonder sometimes why the economy goes down the toilet and why it's so difficult for someone who's trying to do the right thing to struggle economically.
All right, so even with the new leadership?
It's too early to tell, but I haven't seen anything that indicated a change in philosophy.
Okay, so you mentioned making changes to the SAFE Act, which is New York's gun control laws. What kind of changes? And again, do you expect the Assembly to go apart?
Well, no, I don't. They've already said it's dead on arrival, which kind of shows what the new leadership is going to do. But these are not changes to gut what has been the main topic, is to try to get rid of assault weapons and... this doesn't have anything to do with that. It's that ammunition registry. So you're a hunter. So every time you go to a store, you're supposed to be checked out to buy ammunition. And all your dealings are recorded and put in some type of database. Why? Why? It just doesn't make any sense. And plus, it's so complicated and so confusing, which again... going back to our topic on energy, wasn't even studied. It just sounded like a great political idea. And it's been 3 years now. The database hasn't been even set up, let alone in operation, to show how important that was. And so if it's not set up, why start setting it up at millions of dollars expense? Just revisit it and so that it's really not necessary. Mm-hmm. Seven bullets is the most you can have in a magazine. I'm sure most criminals are going to say, oh, wait a minute, before I go shoot somebody, I'm going to let me count my bullets. I don't want to get a ticket for having 10 bullets. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. There's also some provisions about making it easier to pass your guns, maybe a collection, and many people have them, to your relatives, restrictions on who you could pass them off to. Why? If there's been no wrongdoing, why? And so these are not something that things are going to protect people. With these two prison inmates out of the prison, pistol permits have gone up exponentially.
I bet.
And there's people in rural areas that don't have a neighbor within a half a mile. And they're in their homes. Wait a minute, we got only have seven bullets. And these guys are, God knows what they have to come, and so they can't protect themselves. So those are the types of things. Common sense, annoying, unnecessary, costly parts of the SAFE Act, because the only reason we did that and not a total repeal is somebody won't even consider reasonable changes, let alone a total repeal. It's and no doubt if it passed, the governor would veto it because this is one of his signature pieces of legislation. And at least it sounds good in a soundbite.
Right. He likes to be first in the nation, have New York be first in the nation for almost everything, it seems.
Well, he's accomplishing that in some respects, first in the nation of bills that don't work, or first in the nation in tax breaks that are truly too generous without results. So I don't know. I guess it sounds like I'm getting a little sour this last week. When you see this all session long and you can't understand the logic, and we're now coming to a head trying to finish the legislative session out, I would hope that someone would be inspired to just think logically and try to do things based not on what the best political bang for the buck is, but basically what the best policy is.
Right. Moving on now, you recognized a girl from Fayetteville. She is raising awareness for arteriovenous malformation. It's a rare medical condition that affects her veins and her blood vessels. Let's show you introducing her during session.
AVM is a rare condition that affects approximately 300,000 Americans, and one such American is here today. Kaylee Gustafson, were their parents and her physician, Dr. Eric DeShays. It's a very difficult condition. She's had it since she was 4 years old. Could you just stand while I, Kaylee? Absolutely beautiful woman that goes through very difficult times because of this condition. And she started an organization called Kaylee's Cause when they lived in Michigan. Now they live in central New York, and I'm very proud of that. And she wants people to at least know about this disease and start spreading the word so that there could be more research.
So you asked the governor to declare July 19th through 15th AVM Awareness Week in the state of New York.
That's correct. And although she looks perfectly fine from a distance, she's got, you know, the veins are it affects everything in her body, the pain and the discomfort and everything. She had it since she was 4 years old. That's when they discovered what it was. And she's now in college doing extremely well, but trying to do something to let people know there's a condition that nobody knows about, and maybe we should bring some awareness to it.
Definitely. Now let's end with a political satire that you participated in. You played the sax during your bit and explained who you model your style after.
Kenny G. Bill Clinton. And the great Clarence Clemens.
there he is with the boss. I have a lot of other favorite things. One is Bill de Blasio. He's one of my favorite things because he helped the Republicans win back the majority this fall. And we, believe me, we appreciate it.
So explain what you did there. You would play the saxophone and then you'd go and you'd tell some jokes.
Well, for over 100 years, I think 115 thereabouts, the Legislative Correspondents Association has done a spoof on the legislature and the governor at the end of session. And they did it this year, and I was asked to do the rebuttal on behalf of the Senate, and the new speaker was asked to do the rebuttal on behalf of the Assembly. And that was part of my rebuttal, and we've gotten good reviews on it, and especially people who know the things that happen in Albany and know the players and understand the punchlines. But it was fun. It was fun.
We have one more clip I want to show. Anyone who's been watching your voice this year will really get a kick out of this one.
So that's why I'm asking you as acting commissioner. This was available to you as it was to me, and you knew you were going to testify. So, do you know the answer or not?
Senator, I do not know the answer, but we can get back to you.
That's what this is for. Is there anybody, any of your people that you are going to go to that would know the answer?
Yeah, Senator, there is, and we will get back to you.
I'm asking this. Is there anybody in your office, and if you can give the name, who you're going to go back to that to get back to us?
And once I do get that, I can, you know, get back to you and share that information with you.
All right. So you don't know the person you're going to go to ask the questions to get back to us?
I would love to have that discussion with you, but at this point, I'm just not sure if we would have enough time to really give you an answer and a thoughtful answer at this hearing.
Has anybody in your department read this bill? Because you said an awful lot of times, I'll get back to you, I'll get back to you, I'll get back to you.
I would very much want to make sure.
I know what you want to do, because I said, are you able to?
There are people, right, my staff is sitting behind me.
Okay, these are obvious questions that we would ask. Is your general counsel here?
Yes, she is.
Could she come down? Would you be willing to have her come down and answer these questions directly? Are we trying to determine whether she's here? Because no one's getting up. I'm sorry I'm late, but I was at the LCA show doing my performance.
How did it go?
It went all right, but it wasn't nearly as funny as the Governor's Transparency Summit, and not as good as when we did debate these bills on the floor during the budget.
Oh, I do always enjoy those. You know, those are very nice new glasses.
Well, thank you.
Try it again. It's thank you.
Thank you.
A little bit longer. Thank you.
Thank you.
You got it.
What are the specials?
Senator, I do not know the answer, but we can get back to you.
Well, is there anyone in the kitchen who has read the menu so that either they or you could tell me what the specials are?
Senator, there is, and we will get back to you.
You keep saying you're going to get back to me. You're going to get back to me. What are the specials?
You know, I would love to have that discussion with you, but at this point, I'm just not sure if we would have enough time to really give you an answer and a thoughtful answer.
Boy, he sounds familiar.
I think he might have testified before us once or twice.
That's what happened to him. The actual questions I was asking him, and he's a real person, he was an acting commissioner, believe it or not, were was not part of the skit. We just pulled some of that out because that actually happened, and which is remarkable. So I try to get answers. We talked about some of those earlier on in the program, and that's sometimes what you get.
Right, and that's the raise the age for criminal responsibility, and that's coming up maybe at the end of session.
Possibly.
All right, so that whole skit, everyone should check it out. It's on your website, defrancisco.misenate.gov. So at the end of session, at the end of this week, are you going to come back and let us know what happened?
Of course, of course.
Very good.
Hopefully something, some good actions and stopping some bad actions, and hopefully we can do a little of each.
Thanks so much, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For more information on the legislation we discussed, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.